it's not so white here, look. Bad example. Ignore sweater dog people. A tote bag full of kale. You're killing me, lady. Okay, maybe this neighborhood is mostly too, completely too insufferably white, but that's just the way things are here. It doesn't mean we're racist.
I'm sure you're not, Ron, but the fact that so many suburbs are mostly white is no accident. It's the result of decades of racist federal policy that affect us to this day. Look.
Hooray, games!
What the heck kind of game is this?
It's Settlers of the Suburbs, Redlining Edition.
Cool!
Little Donovan, you be green. Ron, you're red.
All right, red, just like the name. Looks like I've got the advantage.
No, you don't. See, in the 1930s, as part of the New Deal, FDR created loan programs to help Americans finance their homes. But to decide who got those loans, the government created color-coded maps in which green neighborhoods were good and red neighborhoods were bad. This practice became known as redlining. Because of these policies, if you lived in the green neighborhoods, it was super easy to get a home loan.
All right, I can buy property.
But for folks in the red areas, no loans were available.
I can barely afford rent with this. It's no fair, the red areas are screwed.
Yeah, they were. And do you know why some areas were designated as red?
No, but I can guess.
Those were the neighborhoods where African Americans and other minorities lived, and redlining systematically prevented them from getting home loans.
Well, I know what I'll do. Just take my little guy and put him in the green neighborhood.
Sorry, that's against the rules. Early suburb developers like William Levitt instituted explicitly racist policies.
Levittown homes must not be used or occupied by any person other than members of the Caucasian race.
And the federal government itself encouraged developers to discriminate.
Developers, I want you to exclude non-whites.
The result of these policies is that from 1934 through 1968, a whopping 98% of home loans were given to white families.
Yes.
Okay, this is not fair. I did not get to pick what color I was when I started.
Yeah, no one does. And this advantage compounded over time. The families in the green or white neighborhoods were able to purchase homes and accrue wealth.
The market went up. I can sell my house and buy a bigger one.
Whereas the people in the red neighborhoods got none of those opportunities.
I can't afford property. I'm behind on my electric bill.
In the green neighborhoods, the influx of new wealth attracted new businesses.
Whoa, we got an organic grocery.
Which caused property values to go up. Which meant white families could sell their homes and send their kids to college.
They grew up so fast.
Passing down their wealth and advantages to future generations. Meanwhile, the red neighborhoods had far less ability to build wealth, and many remained trapped in poverty.
This game is rigged.
Yeah, it was. That's why laws were eventually passed that made most of these discriminatory practices illegal.
Great! Finally, I can move. And I don't have enough money.
Exactly. Without wealth, families in the red neighborhoods couldn't afford to move up, keeping these communities separated by race. Today, 70 years after Levittown was created, it's still less than 1% black.
I may be dead, but the effect of my racism lives on.
And if the neighborhoods are segregated, that means the schools are too.
What? No, that can't be true. We ended school segregation back in the 60s.
Sorry, Ron, but I'm afraid that's not true.
Ron, this is Nicole Hannah-Jones. She's a New York Times investigative reporter who covers civil rights issues, including school and housing segregation. Nicole, would you mind telling Ron what most people get wrong about segregation?
People tend to think of segregation as an archaic term for Jim Crow policies that led to the civil rights movement. But the truth is that black children are more segregated in schools now than at any time since the 1970s.
And in the U.S., schools are largely funded by property taxes. Since property values in the white neighborhoods are so much higher, their schools get way more money to spend on things like facilities, teachers, and supplies.
On the other hand, predominantly Black and Latino schools are massively underfunded. They're less likely to have AP, science, and math courses, and they're the least likely to have experienced and qualified teachers.
The truth is, Lil Donovan doesn't just go to the best school, he goes to a segregated school.
No.
This is a direct result of decades of redlining policies enacted by our own government to build the suburbs. Highways that were built to make access to the suburbs easier for white Americans were often run right through Black middle-class neighborhoods, destroying them.
People in the past were the worst.
It's not just the past. Banks still regularly charge Black homebuyers higher rates on loans than they do white homebuyers, even when they have the same credit. Worst of all, Black and Latino home seekers still experience 4 million incidents of illegal housing discrimination every year.
But, I mean, I didn't do any of that stuff. I'm not racist, and I worked hard to get this house.
Of course, but without realizing it, you've also gotten a leg up from America's history of racist housing policies. The suburb you live in was built on a foundation of segregation, and we can't close our eyes to that. Hey, Adam here. If you like that, be sure to watch all new episodes of Adam Ruins Everything every Tuesday at 10 on truTV.